In this series of two episodes, I will attempt to decipher some of the things we see when we watch a rocket launch. More precisely, I will focus on what we can learn just by looking at the flames coming out of the rocket nozzle. A word of warning, to avoid a multiple hour video, I will have to skip over many rocket propulsion concepts, but don't worry, I'll come back to them later in a series of videos focused on the detailed workings of rocket engines. More information about this new YouTube channel and the reference documentation at the end of the video. The ignition of a rocket engine is always a critical moment. It goes from producing no thrust to full thrust in a few seconds, while going through intermediate regimes it was not really designed for. It's a period of instability, especially for liquid rocket engines, and it should not last more than a few seconds to avoid damaging the engine. During ignition, one can see the engines shake, rattle, buckle, and spit out an unstable plume, as the combustion is far from being ideal due to poor propellant mixing. Thus, unburned fuel is often ejected in the form of black soot for kerosene-fueled engines. This transient phenomenon is not usually visible for solid boosters, as it's almost instantaneous for them. While the engines are off, you have probably already noticed all the water spraying at the base of the rockets. I'm sure you're familiar with the very loud noise produced by a rocket launch, a sound so powerful that sound wave reflecting off the ground could damage the launch vehicle or even the payload. For this reason, deluge or water is sprayed under most launch vehicles to dampen the sound wave and protect both the engines and the launch pad. The launch pad, often thought to be near indestructible, is in fact very fragile once exposed to the rocket plume. By the way, when a launch pad has such a water spraying system, the large smoke-like clouds that can be seen at liftoff actually consist more of steam and water droplets than exhaust products from the engines. One more note, you can see on this video how Ariane 5 actually produces smoke rings out of its flame trench due to the startup vortices around the exhaust plume. During this initial stage, one can also observe the ignition systems at work. I will start though by pointing out that the sparks that you can see here under the space shuttle rocket nozzles play no role in the ignition. It's a commonly made mistake, but these sparks are here to consume the unburned propellants around the base of the rocket. Otherwise, they would accumulate and at some point possibly generate a small explosion that could be detrimental to the ignition sequence. Anyway, let's forget these sparks and focus on the real ignition systems. Let's start with the Merlin engine from SpaceX, which is ignited using a pyrophoric material. This means that this material will react instantaneously when in contact with oxygen, a very useful feature indeed for an ignition system. The Merlin engine uses triethyl borane mixed with triethyl aluminum. As its name indicates, triethyl borane contains boron, which is known to burn with a green flame when combined with oxygen. During the startup of the Merlin, pressurized helium is sent through the turbopumps to start them up and bring propellants to the combustion chamber within a fraction of a second. At the same time, these pyrophoric materials are released in the combustion chamber to initiate the flame that will ignite the main propellants when they are injected a few moments later. For the Merlin engine, these propellants will be oxygen and kerosene, hence the brief green boron-based flame that precedes the main yellow flame. Observe this green glow here. And here. Or here. Here at re-ignition during the entry of the stage. Or here. I think you get the point. Somewhat related to pyrophoric materials which react in air instantaneously, hypergolic materials, a term which is more widely known, reacts instantaneously with each other, and no need of any additional oxygen. The Titan II rocket, who carried the Gemini spacecraft into space, used hypergolic propellants and thus did not require any ignition systems since nitrogen tetroxide and aerosine 50 react on contact. Unlike the Merlin engine, the turbopumps of the Titan's engines would be started using solid powder charges that burn for 1 second approximately, and would bring them up to their steady state speed. What's funny with that launch vehicle is that one can easily hear the startup process when the powder charges are detonated. Listen. And that's not the only rocket to make that type of noise. Please enjoy the startup noise of the Merlin turbopumps. I love that sound. And now, listen to the rumble of the F1 turbopumps from Saturn V first stage. By the way, you can notice that the engines are laid up sequentially and not simultaneously for the Saturn V, as it's the case for many launch vehicles with multiple engines, such as the Angara rocket. Listen in. It was a bit fast, so let's play it once again. Finally, one last fun ignition system to investigate is the one from Soyuz. It's really basic, but very reliable. They simply use wooden sticks attached to each exhaust nozzle. Each of these sticks contains 4 pyrotechnic charges called PZU that will light up the propellants. At takeoff, these sticks burn up in the exhaust flame while being blown off by the flow. By the way, let's take advantage of this wonderful viewpoint under the Soyuz rocket to show you the different stages of its startup sequence. First, the turbines in these engines, which power the turbopumps that supply the propellants, are spun up using gases produced by the decomposition of hydrogen peroxide. The valve that regulates the pressure of these gases is opened in 3 steps, which give us 3 different types of flames to observe before liftoff. Let's go back to the previous shot and review these steps in slow motion. First, the main oxygen valves are opened and the PZU are set off to burn with the oxygen. 3 seconds later, the main fuel valves are opened slightly and the turbopumps are spun up. During this initial thrust phase, the 4 boosters and the central core are only running at 5% capacity, while several parameters are monitored before continuing the launch sequence. Then 5 seconds later, the 4 boosters are simultaneously transitioned to a high power regime, and they are maintained at 70% max power, while the central core remains at 5% max power. Hence the long flame at the center due to poor mixing combustion. This flame disappears as we enter the last phase of the launch sequence. During this final step, the 4 boosters go to 100% power, while the central core goes to 70% max power. This is enough to lift off the Soyuz rocket. Alright, let's rewind and watch it once again at real speed. When the engines start up, there is often unwanted combustion near the base of the vehicle because of unburned propellants. Sometimes these burned gases can move up the side of the rocket because of buoyancy. It can be pretty impressive, as seen here prominently with the Delta IV Heavy launch vehicle, a king of this phenomenon. Looking at this footage, it would seem something is wrong with the launch, as it's unusual to see the rocket already half blackened by fire while still on the launch pad. But no, while surprising, these flames were predicted and deemed acceptable by the engineers. It was even more impressive during the early flights of the Delta IV Heavy when the rocket was literally on fire as it cleared the pad. And now have a look at this night launch of a Delta IV. Once the engines generate enough thrust after ignition, they create a low pressure region under the rocket because of the high velocity of the exhaust gases. This is the Venturi effect, predicted by Bernoulli's law. There is also an entrainment effect on the surrounding air by the exhaust plume. Overall, this results in lots of air getting pulled towards the nozzle exhaust. Thus, we can see flames that go up first, but then turn around if they are close enough from the nozzle, sucked in by the exhaust plume and its low pressure. As you can see, this was particularly striking with the Saturn V rocket. Let's fast forward a few seconds and let's take a look at these rockets as they clear the pads. We notice right away that the flames coming out of the nozzle can take on different colors. Rose, yellow, orange if burning some specific hypergolics, white, blue, violet, multicolor, and even transparent for some propellants such as hydrogen oxygen, like here on the space shuttle. There are several factors that contribute to this variety of flame colors. For instance, solid rocket boosters spit out large molecules, if not pieces of propellants or soot. All these warm particles thus emit an intense light, as seen here because of black body radiation, like light bulb filaments, your fireplace, or the sun. That is why all the solid rocket boosters have such a bright yellow-white flame. They are good approximations of so-called black bodies. On the other hand, engines that use oxygen and hydrogen as propellants, like on the Space Shuttle or Ariane 5, produce barely visible flames as they exhaust water vapor without any large carbon-containing molecules. Here is the emission spectrum for hydrogen and visible light. As you can see, it's mostly in blue and violet, plus the famous H-alpha line in the red. But the most energetic lines, the three on the left here, are comparatively brighter at higher temperatures than the H-alpha line. Since the nozzle exhaust gases are still very hot, it's no surprise that we find these blue tones in the flames of most oxygen-hydrogen engines like the Space Shuttle. But there are a few exceptions, like the RS-68 engine from the Delta IV launcher. Despite also using oxygen and hydrogen as propellants, it produces a yellow flame, as can be seen here. In fact, the throat of the nozzle is lined with an ablative carbon layer, and this carbon ends up in the flame, giving it this yellow color. So what you see here in the flames comes from that ablative coating that is reacting with the exhaust. Rocket engines usually use more fuel than oxidizer, for reasons that will be explored in another video. What matters here is that we have an excess of hydrogen in the exhaust gases, and these hydrogens want nothing more than react with the oxygen from the surrounding air. This brightens the blue tones of the flame thanks to the previously highlighted hydrogen spectrum. This phenomenon is a lot more apparent with kerosene engines like the ones of the Falcon 9, Soyuz or Saturn V rockets. All these engines use a gas generator cycle, which means a small quantity of fuel and oxidizer are diverted from the main chamber and are instead burned in a small, separate chamber. This small combustion chamber next to the main one is what is called the gas generator, as it produces gas to power the turbine part of the turbopump. That is the turbopump that feeds propellant from the tank to the main combustion chamber. These gases are then ejected without producing much thrust through a separate exhaust. And once again, this gas generator usually operates with more fuel than is optimally required in order to increase the life of the engine. This fuel-rich mixture produces relatively cool combustion products deprived of oxygen that are not too damaging to the metal parts of the turbine. To keep it short here, since we will revisit this in a later video, just remember that the combustion products from the gas generator are fuel-rich, not particularly hot, and they have to be dumped overboard one way or another. Among the engines that use this famous gas generator, most employ an exhaust pipe, or simply exhaust, to discard the burnt gases. It's easily spotted here on both sides of the Vulcan 1 engine that powered the first stage of Ariane 5 until 2004. By the way, there are two exhausts here because Vulcan has two gas generators for two independent turbopumps for fuel and oxidizer. Sometimes the exhausts are clearly visible during launches, as shown here with the Atlas rocket. You see the yellow plume on the side? In this zoomed-in view, we can clearly see the exhaust pipe. The flame coming out of it looks dark because of the relatively cold temperature of the burned gas as mentioned earlier. The same observation can be made for several launch vehicles, like the Saturn 1, where one can spot four different exhaust nozzles. In this footage, we can see three of these nozzles spitting out this cold gas that is mostly useless for propulsion. Similarly, this nozzle is perfectly visible next to the Merlin engine from SpaceX. And you can see them here alongside the YF-20 engines on the Chinese Long March rockets. In other versions of gas generator cycle engines, for example the F1 engine of Saturn V first stage, the J2 engine of Saturn V second stage, Ariane 5 Vulcan 2 engine, or even the groundbreaking V2 from Nazi Germany, these cold gases are not discarded via a separate nozzle. Instead, they are re-injected in the main flow path through a series of small orifices, sometimes upstream of the throat as seen here on the V2 engine, but usually downstream of the nozzle throat for the more modern engines. This few hundred degrees Celsius called the fuel-rich mixture cannot burn there, as the exhaust gases are also devoid of oxygen. So it's still not contributing much thrust to the rocket, but it's forming a protective film along the nozzle walls that shield them from the thermal stress of the hottest gases. Take a look at the nozzle exit. These kind of dark curtains that make the exhaust look dirty are in fact just the film of cooler gases that has been shaped into a cylinder around the flame. Since these cooler gases are products of a fuel-rich mixture, these curtains contain unburned fuel that can react with the oxygen from the surrounding air once out of the nozzle. This is not dissimilar to the burning of the excess hydrogen around the space shuttle that we saw earlier. It takes some time for the fuel and oxygen to mix with each other, and since the exhaust speed is very high, the fuel and oxygen only start reacting with each other a few tenths of centimeters downstream of the nozzle exit. There, a new flame front is formed from the mixing of the cold fuel-rich gases and the surrounding air. The speed of this flame front more or less matches the speed of the outer layer of the exhaust, which gives the impression that the flame is trying to catch up with the rocket engine, without ever succeeding. This post-combustion, of course, provides no useful thrust to the engine, as it occurs outside of the nozzle. It is just a secondary effect from the release of unburned fuel, but it can be damaging for the engine as it increases its thermal load. This phenomenon is very apparent on the Saturn V here, as it clears the launch pad. More complicated now. What do you think is happening here for the Saturn 1B? This rocket had 8 H1 engines with open cycles, that is with gas generators. Only the 4 outer engines discarded the gas generator exhaust into the main combustion chamber upstream of the throat, just like the V2 that heavily inspired the H1 engine. And so the dark curtains followed by the bright flame front are only visible for these 4 exhausts. The inner engines exhausted these gases through separate external nozzles, and thus their flames remained clear. Can you see the difference? This other view also highlights the differences between the 4 inner and the 4 outer engines. Regarding the small white pieces that rain down the launch pad after ignition, they are simply bits of water ice that come off the launch vehicle as it starts vibrating when the engines are on. This ice forms before the launch, as cryogenic propellants like oxygen are loaded in the rocket. The water vapor from the surrounding air does not just condensate, but forms an ice sheet along the very cold walls of the tanks. This is why it's very common to see this ice rain for most of launches, as most of the space launchers use at least liquid oxygen as propellant. As we witness the liftoff of an Atlas V rocket from an onboard camera, highlighting some of the phenomena we described earlier, this episode is already 18 minutes long, and we still are only a few meters off the ground. However, in my opinion, some of the most interesting features seen in rocket flames only occur later in the flight. Thus, let's plan on meeting again soon for the next episode in this series focused on rocket flames. This accelerated footage of the Atlas V launch gives you a taste of what will be discussed next time. Sources and references are from widely available public sources, such as books or scientific papers. All these references are listed in the description of the video. This episode was just a test for me, as I have no clue about how my very poor English accent will be received by an international audience. Please let me know what's your opinion about this video in the comment section, and if the feedback is good, I will make new videos on this channel. I also take a moment to thank all of you that may support me through Patreon. Thanks to you, this channel will improve its quality and also hopefully expand its horizons by shooting episodes from exciting varied places. Thanks to all of you who watched this video, and hopefully, see you all very soon for the sequel of this episode on rocket flames.